welcome you all here to our commemoration of the 50th anniversary of D-Day. This means a lot to us here in the National Park Service. This yard that's part of our park is very instrumental in the D-Day operation and Operation Overlord. So I think it's very meaningful that we pay homage not only to veterans of D-Day, and also later we'll be paying homage to the war dead of the Korean conflict, but also at this memorial states to those who gave their lives, the Navy Yard workers who gave their lives in all wars from 1800 to 1950. That covers a lot of time. And this is not only those who died in combat, but we must also remember, I think, that the work here in the Navy Yard was dangerous work, and that a number of people did give their lives building the ships that helped us prosecute the wars that preserved freedom throughout that period of time and since then. So let's remember all of them today. And at this time, I would ask some of our honored guests here, Captain Street, Sergeant McGillivray, and Mr. Barton, to help me lay the wreath at the memorial of the shipyard workers. Now we will be proceeding over the Korean War Memorial. We'll ask that we be preceded by our protection vehicle, the Marine Honor Guard, Constitution Color Guard. So it's very fitting that we have Captain Street, Sergeant McGillivray here to honor the Korean War dead. This beautiful memorial is a fitting tribute to them. At this time, I'd like to lay the wreath at this memorial. Gentlemen, if you'll help me, please.
Is that?
this time, I'd like Mr. Brad Chase, Vice President of the Korean War Veterans Association, to say a few words, Mr. Chase.
On behalf of the Korean War Veterans Association of Massachusetts, I would like to welcome all of you today as we all join in the celebration of D-Day. This memorial that you're looking at was erected and dedicated last July 27th, which was the 40th anniversary of the ceasefire in Korea. Korea has been called many times the forgotten war, but I hasten to point out that it was a forgotten victory, for had it not the United States Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Coast Guard gone to Korea, the Republic of Korea may not have been in existence today. It was the first time that the United States or the world stood up to worldwide communism. And as a result of that war, over 54,246 men and women were killed. Over 103,000 were wounded. And to this day, we have approximately 8,177 MIAs that were never accounted for. So as we gather here today, I hope you would all keep in mind that we pray for those of World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Panama, Grenada, Somalia, all the veterans that serve. And keep in mind the brave men and women that serve in the military forces today, which continue to make this the greatest nation on the earth.
Unfortunately, too often we hear that a conflict is called the forgotten war, or it's a war that people feel is distasteful and we don't want to remember. We must remember these things. At this time, I'd like Captain George Street, U.S. Navy retired, Congressional Medal of Honor recipient, to say a few words.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lankos. The remarks that were just made by esteemed colleague are certainly to the point. I think we're preaching to the choir, but maybe we all should review the fact that Korea today is a very dangerous situation for the United States and for the free world. As President Sigmund Rhee used to say, the Korean Peninsula is pointed like a dagger at the heart of Japan. And you know how hard Japan fought in World War II against us. We fought against them. And Japan is a major economic force in the world, and we certainly want to keep it free, rather than remilitarize again and doing the thing over again, what they did in December the 7th, 1941, Pearl Harbor Day. I will recall being at the Armed Forces Staff College. My colleagues in the Army and the United States Air Force and Marine Corps were very much disturbed that no one's paying any attention to the buildup of forces north of the militarized zone along the 38th parallel in Korea. And all of a sudden, the current present ruler of North Korea, a dictator and semi-crazy, suddenly plunged across the DMZ, the 38th parallel, south in the capital of the Republic of Korea, Seoul, and took it in a matter of hours. And we only had cooks and bakers and clerks to fight them in the U.S. Army. They flew them over from Tokyo in Japan as part of MacArthur's staff. And it was a desperate fight to keep the peninsula in the hands of the Allies, that is, the United States and the Republic of Korea. Later, the United Nations did vote to come in as the United Nations forces, and General MacArthur was then appointed to command all the United Nations forces. But the main backbone of those forces were the United States and the Republic of Korea. The others chipped in good things like medical units and helpful units like that. The Turks were extremely hard fighting, only had a battalion, and I was told any time a Turk was taken prisoner, he brought with him his rifle, would fight it out, and would get killed rather than lose his rifle. And our Marine colleagues know how that is, so I think they feel the same way. God bless you all for coming. Have a good weekend. We appreciate the Nashville coming in. I'm honored to be at this ceremony. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. This time I would ask Sergeant Charles McGillivray, U.S. Marine Corps retired, Congressional Medal of Honor recipient, to say a few words. Sergeant McGillivray.
910. Captain Street, Mr. Conway, past president, past command of the American Legion, all the servicemen, old sound mothers, if there's any here. We've become a nation of wars, and a nation of veterans. We get 27 million veterans in the United States. We're celebrating the 50 years of Normandy, and we're in Omaha Beach, 6 o'clock in the morning, and there's a lot of men there drowned before they even hit the beach. And I've seen enough battles in Europe, and I've been to Korea, Panmunjom, 38 parallel, for the State Department, the United States. The Korean War, after World War II, they could call it a police action, a conflict, whatever they want to call it. It's a war. You send a man 10,000 miles away from his home, free nation, he's fighting for three other people. It's a war. Well, they went to Vietnam, another conflict. In my book, it's a war. War is hell. Believe me, we can't glorify it. The only thing we can do is remember the men, such as we lost in Korea. Those are the real heroes. The man that lays down his life for his nation at the age of 18, 20, 21. After all, I've seen my life. I'm 77 years old. Very good fortune to come back, but I'm back here to talk about it. When I was president of the Medal of Honor Society, I visited graveyards from the French Bowl, South Pacific, to Arlington, France, and Holland. They call them white crosses, David. I call them pillars of freedom. They're the men that set us free. That's why we're talking here tonight, today. If we didn't have men like on this podium that went and give their country up, give their life up for their country and made the supreme sacrifice, we would be. But I got to tell the veterans right here today, they got to stick together, whether it's the Korean War, the Vietnam War, or whether it's a World War II. Because I've been interested in a lot of legislation in Congress, and all they want to know is numbers. They want you split. You should not split, you should stick together, and you shall get something for this. You're what this nation is all about. I would like you.
Thank you, Sergeant McGilvray. I guess I consider it my loss to not be part of the great brotherhood, and I guess today sisterhood also, of veterans in this country. But I do thank all veterans for my freedom and for everyone's freedom. I wish I were part of your number, because we have all of you to thank, especially like you, Sergeant, those who both today were honored, both who came back from Normandy, and especially those who did not come back. So while we might be enjoying the vehicle displays and the Army band concert and other things today, we need to keep in mind this is not a celebration, it's a commemoration, and that we need to remember those who returned and those who didn't return. This time I'd ask Mr. John Benjamin, our Deputy Superintendent, to just say a couple of words, please.
I want to thank all of you for coming and for making this tribute to our veterans. As everyone here has said, it's so fitting and so right. We have so much to be thankful for, so much that we have gained from their sacrifices, that we owe them such a debt. And it is only right that we remember them and remember them fondly and well and often. Thank you very much for taking your time to be here.
I would like to add my thanks to John for all of our veteran dignitaries here, to Captain Otterbein and the officers and crew of USS Nashville, who are to a great degree making this a very successful weekend already. It's a great ship. I was very proud to be on board her yesterday to ride her back into port, and it was a great experience that I'll always remember. And I thank everyone for how kind they've been to us so far. And I know the public tours will be a great success. Everyone will love them, and we really appreciate your coming here today. And this is a wonderful turnout. I do thank you all. And also thank you for the wonderful Marine Honor Guard that you've provided. The Sergeant and his Honor Guard have done a fantastic job. And I also thank Commander Richard Amaral and the officers and crew of USS Constitution and the fine color guard they've provided today. Thank you very much.
We're going to play the Armed Forces Salute, which is the service songs of the Army, the Navy, the Marines, the Air Force, and the Coast Guard. And we would ask that you would stand and be recognized when we play your service song. Ladies and gentlemen, the Armed Forces Salute. Anybody from the Coast Guard? Anybody from the Coast Guard on deck today? Not yet. Okay. Marines. Any Marines here this afternoon? All right. Nice hand for the Marines today. Anybody else out there from the Marines? All right. Terrific. Glad you're here this afternoon. The Navy, United States Navy, here we go. Nice hand for all the Navy.
From the North Shore Old Car Club. We've got a number of cars here today from the pre-1941 era. We've got 40 Buick. We have a Model T Ford, a 1938 Buick big sedan. My car is a 1939 Ford convertible coupe with a rumble seat. We have a 37 Ford sedan, a 50 Chevrolet, and about a 1940 Plymouth and an old Ford Model A down at the end. The club frequently participates in events of this nature, and it's a lot of fun. I'm glad we could be here to help set the theme for the day.
We'd also like to continue and have you reminisce or remember at this time all the men and women who have served and those that continue to serve, and of course especially the MIAs, men and women who have fought and died to make this country free and the greatest nation on earth. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to do America the Beautiful. July 4th, 1776, and the Declaration of Independence is my birth certificate. The bloodlines of the world run through my veins, for I offer freedom to the oppressed. I am many things and many people. I am the nation. I'm 250 million living souls and ghosts of millions who have died for me. I'm Nathan Hale and Paul Revere. I stood at Lexington and fired the shot heard round the world. I'm Washington, Jefferson, and Patrick Henry. I'm Generals Lee and Grant and Abraham Lincoln. I remember the Alamo, the Maine, and Pearl Harbor. When freedom called, I answered and stayed until it was over over there. I left my heroic dead in Flanders Fields, the rocks of Corregidor, the bloody hills of Korea, the steaming jungles of Vietnam, and the winds of Desert Storm. I'm the Brooklyn Bridge, the rolling wheat fields of Kansas, the ever watchful granite hills of Vermont. I'm the coal fields of the Virginias, the Grand Canyon, and the Golden Gate,
I'm Independence Hall, the Monitor, and the Merrimack. And I'm forest, and I'm field, and mountain, and desert. I'm the quiet villages and the cities that never sleep. I'm the ballot dropped into the box and the roar of the crowds, the voice of the choir in the chapel. You see me in the lights of Christmas and hear me in the strains of Auld Lang Syne as the calendar turns each year. Yes, I am the nation, and these are the things that I represent. I was conceived in freedom, and God willing, in freedom I'll spend the rest of my days. May I possess always the integrity, the courage, and the strength to keep myself unshackled, to remain a citadel of freedom and a beacon of strength to the rest of the world. This is my goal, my hope, and my prayer.
Everybody, my name is Ensign Siniger, and I'd like to welcome you aboard USS Nashville. This is LPD 13, and we are the original Top Gator. Now, when we say LPD, the Navy likes to use a three-letter code to help define a ship, helps to identify its ships. LPD standing for Amphibious Transport Dock. What we do, our primary mission is to conduct amphibious operations. It's the same mission that the LSTs that were originally built here in the Boston Navy Yard conducted some 50 years ago over in Europe during D-Day. Now when we do these, what we do is we come pier side and we can fill the ship up with Marines, between 400 to 900 Marines, fill up all their equipment, all their supplies, all their ammunition, everything that is that they're going to need to conduct an amphibious operation. What we can then do is we set sail, we can travel anywhere in the world, land the Marines on any beach that they need to go to. I don't know if you, when you were walking up the pier, I don't know if you saw our stern back there. It's very square, it's very boxy in shape. What that actually is, that's a gate or a door. It opens up, lowers down, allows the ship to fill up with water, and actually sinks the ship down about 12 feet, 12 feet further into the water. What we've got down below us is our wet well. And this is where the water comes. This is where we have our amphibious craft. We have a safe haven down there when we fill it up with water. And you'll get to see this a little later on during the tour. When our craft are down there, we can load our Marines into there, all their supplies, and they come right out our stern and we drive them right onto the beach. We also, this is our flight deck here. We don't normally deploy with helicopters, but we deploy with other ships that do in our task group. And what they do is they fly their helos aboard us, land, and we load the Marines on, and we can actually fly them directly to the beach. This helps to expedite the entire landing process, while at the same time giving the Marines a greater flexibility to where they might want to go. Now this is, as I said, USS Nashville. We are named after, obviously, the city of Nashville. But the city itself was named after General Francis Nash. General Nash was unfortunately mortally wounded during the American Revolution, but during that war he did have a chance to serve with General George Washington. General Washington said of General Nash that he was one of the best soldiers they ever worked with, and he was one of the bravest men they'd ever had the chance to fight with. So we're very proud to help carry on the tradition of General Nash. We're also very proud to help honor and serve the city of Nashville, Tennessee. So, once again, I'd like to welcome you all aboard. What I'm going to do, I'm going to give you to our two tour guides here. They're going to take you around the ship with a couple stops set up for you. And there we have different people to talk to you, tell you a little bit more about what the different departments do aboard the ship, let you try to get a better understanding of what our crew does. I am going to ask two things of you, though, while you're aboard us. The first is to be careful when you're walking around. We don't say that you enjoy your tour and have a lovely day while you're here at the Boston Navy Yard. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is ABHAN Massenburg. He'll be talking about the flight deck and flight deck operations.
All right. How's everybody doing?
Oh, man. Put me on the spot there.
As you said, I'm Aaron Massenburg. I'll be telling you about here on the flight deck. What we have here is the hangar. This is basically our storage area. This is where we store any and everything we have to. Up here, we have primary. That is what we use to talk to helos while flying around, here landing on deck, whatever the case may be. We get a few helos while running, shut down, or even 5 feet off the deck at a hover. But we choose not to do it that way because it's the most dangerous. Now, right here, what we have here is our tower unit. This is our first means of our firefighting. We have approximately 60 seconds here. If we can't have the fire out within 60 seconds, we have our HFF hoses and things like that alongside the starboard and port catwalks. If we can't get the fire out by using hoses, we use these here, which we could flood the flight deck with. And we also use these right here in just in case of a chemical attack and things like that. We just use it to flood the flight deck, wash all chemicals away, and things like that. Here we have our huffer. We use this right here in case any helo comes on deck and battery goes down or it's not getting enough APUs or things like that. We use this to jump start it with. Here we have our tow tractor. This is what we use to taxi all helos around on deck. Okay, as I was saying, blue shirts are the ones that chalk and chain. If you look right inside the hangar, we have our tie down chains here. Those are what we use to tie down helos, and we tie them down to these here, which are our clover leaf pad eyes. And here on deck, we can land four cobras at once, which is spot 4, 3, 5, and 6. Our basic means here are basically transport Marines, and that's basically it. Any questions? Y'all have a nice day and a nice tour.
Very much.
Follow me, please. Be careful going up the ladder. I ask that you use the handrails for your own safety.
Go ahead.
Welcome to USS Nashville again. This is the boat deck, and as you said, my name is Seaman Recruit Cordelasso. On the boat deck, we have two boats, PL-1 on the far side. PL-2 is the one nearest to us. PL stands for Personnel Landing Craft. PL-1 is used for the officer's gig and the captain's gig. PL-2 is used as the general enlisted boat and other personnel that may be on. Like right now, we've got some Marines, some Seabees, and sometimes we do have some SEALs on board. Each boat is 36 feet in length, weighs 2,600 pounds, carries the maximum of 21 people and one coxswain to drive the boat. On the far side, we have our B&A crane. The B&A crane is used to hoist the boats up into the water and back onto their hoist. It's also used to transport goods and supplies to and from the pier. And that's pretty much the boat deck. Are there any questions I can answer for anybody?
How many seconds do you have to
take? How long does it take the boat down? It takes a little while, actually. I mean, for emergency purposes, if like we were to have a man to fall overboard or something, we have a motor whaleboat on the port side catwalk, right off the flight deck. And I think what was our fastest recovery time for man overboard? I'm sorry?
6.5 minutes.
6.5 minutes was our fastest recovery time for man overboard. That's to get the boat manned and ready, to get boat down to the water, and to actually get the man overboard inside of the whaleboat. So any more questions? All right, if that's it, you'll have a nice day and enjoy the rest of the tour. You have a great day.
You too.
All right, my name's QM3 Ashley. My primary job on board is navigation, keeping up our charts and our navigation publications. Right here you have the helm, which is used to control the rudders to stay on whatever course we need to get to where we're going. This is our magnetic compass, which we don't really use all that much. We mainly use our gyro repeaters here. You can see them right up here and also there on the helm console. And here we have our EOT, which is used to control our speed. What we'll do is bring up our RPMs, and down in the engine rooms, they'll answer it up and they'll open whatever valves they need to do to answer the order. And over here usually is where the quartermaster watch is working, and he'll have his chart and everything up here. When we're out at sea, this is what we use for our main form of navigation, which is a GPS system. We also have a commercial GPS system right there, and below that we have a Loran Charlie system. And here we have this is a sextant, which we can use specific stars to figure out where we're at. But the only time we can use this is half an hour before sunrise, and half an hour after sunset is only two times in a day that we can use this. And if it's cloudy, you can't really use it at all anyway, so. And this is a statometer here, what we can use to tell how far we are away from basically anything that we know the height of it, a flagpole or a lighthouse or another ship. But it's only good up to about a mile or mile and a half is only a good range that it has. And here we have one of our radar repeaters. It's the same thing as that other gray one on the other side of the room. And we mainly use this for radar navigation and for keeping track of other ships that are in our area, or fishing boats, or whatever other vessels are in our area. And that green radar repeater over there, we also mainly use that keep track of other ships in the area, and it can also be used to keep track of ships. It can pick up aircraft. I'm not really sure on the exact range of it, but we also have our red phones up here, which is a secure phone. If we're talking to another ship, it'll scramble the voice so that nobody can listen in. And then over there in the corner we have the captain's chair, and that's where he sits and makes sure that we're all doing our job up here. And that's pretty much it for up here. Anybody have any questions or?
Total number and when you would see.
Well, when we're open ocean steaming, the watch team is 8 people. But when we're pulling in a port, there are going to be around 15 people up here.
Got it.
Yeah.
The max speed is 22 knots, but that's only emergencies. We're not supposed to go anything over 19 unless it's an absolute emergency. Our normal cruising speed is about 13. That's what we get our best gas mileage at.
How deep you can see submarines? Can you see a submarine?
Well, if it's up, you know, you can see it, but if it's underwater, you can't see it. We don't really have no sonar. The closest thing to sonar we have is we have a fathom, which all that does is it'll send out a ping to the bottom of the ocean, and it measures how long it takes for the ping to hit the bottom of the ocean and for the echo to come back up, and it'll tell how deep the water is. That's the closest thing that we have to any kind of sonar.
Okay, the area up here is the signal bridge. Down below, you were just came from the pilot house. That's where the officer of the deck cons the ship. Up here, the signalman act is professional lookouts for the officer of the deck down below. Okay, up here, we're signalmen. Our area up here is the 05 level and the 04 level. We have three means of communication which we use. We use the hand flags by semaphore, so the 12-inch signal searchlights, and our flags. We haul our flags up on the halyards. We have two flag bags, port and starboard. Each flag bag has 68 flags in it. That's basically all there is to it, and the tour guide's going to go ahead and take you down to the next level, to the weapon systems down there, and they'll be explaining that to you.
Okay.
My name is Pastor Jansen. I work with the Seaway system, as you can see up there. Seaway stands for Colson's Weapon System. The system can shoot 3,000 of these rounds a minute. These are 20-millimeter rounds. You can pass these around. Here. Take a look at them. Those are dummy rounds. The system has the ability to track five targets at a time. And of the five targets, decide which one is the most threatening to the ship and engage that target first. It's a self-contained system. All it requires from the ship is a water supply and electrical supply. Everything else is contained on the mount. Things on the mount that needs to be on the mount. All the electronics, the wave, the radars, and the hydraulics to move the gun. It's a self-aim correcting system. When it realizes that its bullets are missing the target, it automatically self-correct itself so that the bullets hit the target. If y'all look up towards the mount up there, my coworker is going to move the mount real quick.
In AEW auto, which is anti-air warfare, if you engage it to that position, then the mount will search track, and when it was a target coming inbound, then it will shoot it down all on its own. You have to disengage certain safeties. You have two button safeties. You have a mechanical safety up in the gun, which keeps the rounds either chambered or not chambered as they're cycling through. There's two paths. And then the firing key. These are just in the, tells you what's going on with the mount. system status at the moment, whether or not it's a go or a no-go, what's wrong with it. And this is used for maintenance, testing. You can call up if you have a certain signal, it's supposed to go to a switch to engage something, and you don't know, you think the switch is bad, you can call up here that certain signal to tell you whether or not it's going to be, if it's there or not, so you know if the switch is bad or if it's just a signal coming to the switch.
Good afternoon, I'm MS-1 Spriggs, your on duty cook for today. I'll give you a little brief description of how Navy life is for a cook and for the crew. Right, currently we're serving 1,500 to 1,600 meals per day. At sea, with all the Marines on board, we're talking about 24 to 2,600 meals per day. We serve 4 meals a day, breakfast, lunch, dinner, and we serve mid-rats, what we call mid-rats, for the guys who work at night on a late night shift, late watches. We have two main lines, We have one main line and one speed line. Main line consists of two meats, a vegetable, soup, a starch, and of course we have the dessert. Speed line is fast moving items, hamburgers, hot dogs, you know, cheeseburgers, that sort of type of thing. If, as you can see, looking on the mess decks, we don't have a lot of room. So we get the guys in and we move them out because of the space limitation. We're like machines in there sometimes because we're trying to clean and cook all at the same time. You know, it's something to see, man. Well, we have Italian-style veal steaks, we have beef stew, we got butter egg noodles, we got seasoned asparagus, we have rice pilaf, and we have chocolate cake, apple pie, cherry pie, you name it, we got it.
Okay, well, you talk to
Wait, do we have gas to stay for dinner?
Yeah, I don't know if they'll let you guys stay or not, I don't know.
What about wine?
Oh, no, man. If we serve wine, it wouldn't be too much work to get done today, I don't think. But you really don't learn how to cook until you get here on the ships. That's where you really, really learn a lot. You know, you learn a lot. Anything else? Well, in that case, I'm going to turn you over to your tour guide. Thank you for visiting us, and enjoy the rest of your day. All right.
My name is HM3 May, and I'm one of the corpsmen aboard the USS Nashville here. We have a medical department comprised of one medical officer and 8 corpsmen. Each corpsman has training that equal to that of a nurse, and they can do more than that working under the doctor's license. They can actually treat people and diagnose people and work like a doctor on board. Each corpsman also has additional training. We have a laboratory technician on board, a pharmacy technician, and they're specialized in those fields, so we're able to provide a wide range of medical care to the entire crew here and meet the needs of the crew. We have an operating room here which is capable of doing just about any type of surgery we would need to do. However, it's used only for war times because it's kind of small and inadequate, and we have better facilities available at hospitals and bigger ships. So usually we don't use this for that. We use it for either sick call or taking electrocardiograms of their hearts or whatever. We also have a treatment room right over here, and we see sick call there. Now sick call, it consists of people who have colds or non-emergent problems that they want to get taken care of and want the doctor to see them for. And we usually see that between Monday through Friday, hours of 8 to 9, and then we'll take care of the people throughout the day. We also see people any time in the day when they have an emergency or a problem that's got to get taken care of right now. Somebody cuts their hand and they need stitches, they'll come down and we can go ahead and clean them up and give them stitches or whatever else they need. So we're pretty much capable of providing any type of emergency treatment on board that we would need to provide. It's basically basically a mini hospital that we take with us out to the sea, and we can take care of the whole crew even if we're the only ship out there. Normally we have 400 members on board the ship, but when we carry Marines, we have 600 to 700 Marines in addition to the 400 Navy people aboard. So sick call usually doubles or triples in size, and we have more quorum with the Marines, and so it gets pretty crazy around here. But other than that, that's pretty much about it. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Feel free to tour the medical spaces here and see what it's all about. All right?
Set up here for your touring pleasure. At this point, you're pretty much on your own. The exit point for the tour is back here at these double doors. They're selling Nashville emblematic items just before you walk out if you care to purchase a souvenir. There's guys standing around for different displays. Feel free to talk to them. They'll tell you about what goes on up here in Upper B.
Yeah, I was on the destroyer, the USS Nicholas, during World War II from 1942 to 46. And it's quite a change in things since we were, the ship is altogether different than anything we'd ever seen. And it was a great tour, we enjoyed it.
How do you feel about the D-Day celebration?
I think it was great, I think it was a good idea. Hope next year they have more of it.
Oh, it's always nice to come back and see what's going on in the Navy since 30 years ago. And big change in the ships. I had three carriers during World War II. The old Saratoga, which is number three, and they're well up into the 70s now, I guess, with the new nuclear jobs. That's about all I can say. Sorry enough.
Was it a good tour? Did you like it?
It was very tour, very good. Yeah. Sorry we didn't get for the beans and Franks tonight, but that's okay. No, it's really great, and they're well-organized ships.
How about the D-Day celebration?
I'm impressed.
Like?
Very much so. I had a veteran friend of mine who's gone over to Normandy this week to see some of the activities. He's going to be over there for 2 weeks. I wish I could have gone with him, but no chance. We're all in the other direction anyhow. That's all I got to say.
All right, this is the Prick 44 right here. It's used to communicate in the field with, you know, their different platoons, so that they have to know where you're at. It's good ways of weapon. This right here, we use this for go to combat, our gear right here. It's all our gear. You got your gas mask here. You got your douche gear here. You wear this around your body, so, you know, in case you get shot at, you know, you want to try to protect yourself here. You got your canteens on here, first aid kit. You got carry two canteens on there. You got your war belt right there. Let's see, these right here, it's called a PR-24. A lot of police use these right now. We're in a Marine Corps Security Forces. We carry these on post, for, you know, just in case someone tries hitting us or something, protect them like that. This is the M203 machine gate grenade launcher right here. It's basically the same thing as the M16, where they put the grenade launcher on there. So it was about 6 pounds heavier. This is about 8.5, now it weighs probably about 13.5 now. This is an M16A2 service rifle. Every Marine carries this when they go to battle. Everybody carries this right here. 5.56. You got semi on there, shoot one round at a time. You got burst, you shoot three rounds at a time. You got the 870 Mossberg. You shoot a double-odd buck or single-odd buck. Double-odd buck or slug. It shoots about 50 meters, 50 yards around. This is a 9mm service pistol. You put 15 rounds in here and just rack it down like that. Load up. It's fast, you can pull the trigger, fast the rounds will come out. This is a grenade. This is a grenade right here. You got the firing pin. First you use this to pull it off right there. Pull the pin and just throw it. This is sitting there right here. When you blow this off, a big flame comes off, and it will go through metal and everything like this. This right here blows smoke, you know, different colors. This means yellow, it means precaution, something like that. We got green ones, we got blue ones. Green means go, blue, red means stop, you know, in this case there's enemies or something like that.
Yeah, that's powerful.
Hey, hand me. just a pop-up flare. Say if I wanted to shoot this up, light up an area, you know, to let people know where troops are, you know, enemy fire, stuff like that, to get down, take cover, or whatever, like that. This is the M249 machine gun, 5.56. You can shoot 725 meters or 1,000 meters. You got the M60 in the last right there. It's 7.62. You can either shoot, you can shoot about 550 meters with that. That's basically it. And we got the M50 here too. That's 9.96. It should have about 1,500 meters.
Great. All right.
No problem.
Appreciate it.
Hey, Tim. My name is Corporal Garcia. I'm Marine Corps Security Force Academy, attached to USS America. Right now, we're going to give you a demonstration on line one, which is in dock and in style fighting that we're using in the Marine Corps now. Right here, I have Lance Corporal Wilkins and Lance Corporal Llanos. They are both attached to the USS America. Lance Corporal Llanos will be doing the aggressing, and Lance Corporal Wilkins will be defending himself. First line move is first two moves are controlling techniques. The first one is wrist lock, and the second one will be a reverse wrist lock, as they'll demonstrate right now. Attack. Okay, the third technique will be a front choke, which is a killing technique. The next four techniques are four killing techniques. As they will show right here, do it again. The front choke. Front choke, slow it down. Next technique will be a front headlock. Front headlock. Next technique will be a choke. Next technique will be a front choke. As I was again, that was a rear headlock.
Quit, definitely.
For training purposes only, the Marine puts muscular tension on his elbow when he gets supposedly a broken elbow. When the other Marine, the defender, kicks him in his face, the attacker puts his forearm to protect his face, and during the choke and front headlocks, he protects his groin in order so the defender does not hit him in the testicles. That's it.
Seeing what people do on the ship when they're out on sea. And I don't know.
Why'd you get your face painted?
Because of the guy said he can do it real good and make me look like a cobra.
You look like a cobra?
Yeah.
I like the part where we got to see the bullet upstairs.
Why'd you get your face painted?
I don't know. I felt like it. Jen's getting popped.
Do you like coming to the Navy Yard here?
Yeah.
Yes, we have. Everyone that's come through has really enjoyed the tours. They thanked everyone, and they've had a good time, they said.
Do you do this a lot, or is this just a one-time thing?
This is my first time, but ships generally go everywhere, different ports, and we set up for weekends. We get with the Park Service or the different event coordinators, and we do this a lot, though, the Navy does, and the Marine Corps.
It's a place to be.
We've enjoyed ourselves. The crew is all positive. We've enjoyed our stay here. People are friendly, and it's been a good time for everybody. I think it's good because they get a better understanding of what we do and what our job is, and how we live and the different things we have to put up with when we're gone for 6 months. We're on the ship for that whole period, and it's challenging to live with about 1,000 people for 6 months on a ship this size. I enjoy the Marine Corps life. It's challenging, a lot of changes. We can go to different jobs. It's not a same thing all the time.
Right.
It was very interesting, very new for us because it's the first time we see a warship. We are coming from Switzerland. There we don't have such ships.
Yeah.
And
as Swiss without any ships and navy, it's double interesting.
Yes. Do you think it's nice? Are you tourists? Are you visiting here?
We are tourists.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just came in yesterday.
How do you like the Navy Yard all here?
Oh, beautiful.
Yes.
Beautiful. Nice.
Yes. And we are always remembering America, who saved us in the last war.
Yeah. Oh, that's nice to say on D-Day.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Yes. Yes. Appreciate it so much.
The vehicle itself is a Navy Jeep, 1951 vintage. It was assigned to the West Coast. It was then given to the school district in Whittier, California. And then after they used it for about 8 years, it went up for auction. We picked it up in Whittier, California, transported it to the East Coast, and the National Park has done some work on it along with myself, and we've restored it to what it is today. It's basically, right now, 95% finished. It has the markings of the aircraft carrier Yorktown, CVA-10, and also the OR division, which stands for Operational Radio. The Navy used commercial Jeeps. They didn't use the heavy-duty military ones.
Mm-hmm.
But this one does have the markings that it was used, and we definitely know it was used by the Navy. Okay, this truck is an Army, what they call a deuce and a half. It's a 2.5 ton. It's a GMC 1944. Some of the things to notice is in the front it has the power winch. The engine is a 6-cylinder, 92 horsepower. It carries 40 gallons of gasoline. The crew's either 1 or 2. It has no armor, but if you notice up the top, the ring up over the cab, is a track for 50 caliber machine gun, which mounts up there. This particular truck is one of 475 that was made on this particular style.
475?
Yeah.
Really.
No, it isn't. Well, it's not that there wasn't any more made as far as deuces and a half. The fact is that the style with the type of machine gun, it has French markings on it. You notice on your bumpers you have the French flag. Just being able to come here and be living history, I mean, that's what the whole National Park is about.
But before we go, we're going to leave you with a little bit of music. Mr. John Philip Sousa, we'd like to play for you one of his finest marches. It's the National March of the United States of America. It's called Stars and Stripes Forever, the music of Mr. John Philip Sousa. 76th Division, United States Army Reserve Band, East Windsor, Connecticut, ladies and gentlemen. Commander, Chief Warrant Officer, Mr. James J. Turek.
Lisa Wozniak, you here, Lisa? She'll be here a little later. She's president of the New England Military Vehicle Collectors Club. They had a fine display of military vehicles out there today on the pier, and I think a couple of them are still here tonight. She should be back later. The North Shore Antique Car Collectors, I want to thank them also today for their fine display of civilian vehicles from World War II, and some were from before and some after. If any of you saw that today, it was a nice mix of vehicles out there. I'd like to also acknowledge some of the old LSTers we have here. The U.S. LST Association, the Massachusetts chapter, was very helpful with us in that. And one of the things that most of you should already have on your tables is a brochure that's called Large Slogan, Charlestown Navy Yard. And we have several veterans of a couple of those LSTs that were at Normandy. I think there were 11. That were at Normandy, that were built here. And I'd like to mention a few people. Bob Oliver, can you stand up for a second? Bob was with LST 309. Charles Smith, LST 310, right? Okay, I don't know if he's here today. He was here earlier. Ralph Bard, I'm sorry. Ralph Barton was here for our wreath laying ceremonies earlier this today, and I don't think he's come back for the dance, but he was with LST 310 also. And Albert Spina. No? Okay. Well, he should be here later. He was also, I believe, LST 310. And it's interesting because in those brochures, if you look closely, there are two quotes from Mr. Barton and from Mr. Smith. And so they were helpful in putting that together, sharing their memories of Normandy with us. Jim Conway, past president of the American, state president of the American Legion, past national historian of the American Legion. Jim, are you here? I guess I started this a little too early. I guess some people will still be coming. I've forgotten anyone, please forgive me, but please, everyone have a good time. Hopefully you all have a good time and you all get some great dancing in. And please show me some of the steps from the 40s. I need to know them. At this time, before we start the, okay, we'll just go right into the music now. I'd like to introduce Mr. Richard DeLuca and the Richard DeLuca Orchestra. Thank you.
started in Korea. I was not quite old enough for World War II, but went to Korea, well, in the Korean conflict. Weather reconnaissance, out of Bermuda, out of the way.
Yep.
And very enjoyed, but I think this celebration that's going on is very worthwhile. Reminiscence, bringing everyone back to reality.
Yeah.
And I think we need more of it now, and I think people are beginning to see that. And I think we've gone almost in a full circle.
In more ways.
In more ways, I think we've specialized, become a highly specialized country. And I think now we're looking to get back into the old way of things being done. And I think everyone wants to encompass and not just be a specialist. They want to realize what we have, what we can do.
Uh-huh.
And more you see this, bringing back the old methods, the old systems. Mm-hmm. I think computers are tremendous.
Right.
And I think it's relieved a lot of people of a lot of thinking, but I think we have to get back to basic values.
Right, that's a good
and
point.
And you see more things in this. I do a lot of volunteer work, both with the auxiliary, the park service, mm-hmm. and then I'm involved with safety, boating safety, mm-hmm. through the Coast Guard auxiliary. And more people are showing interest, whereas before everyone wanted to get out, be the fastest, go the fastest,
yeah.
be the biggest, and
yeah.
so on. But now people are beginning to realize safety, the values, families. And I think the biggest thing is the migration back to the family effect, or the family feelings, and not just having a good time. But I'm on the short end of the cycle now, but you want to see the young folks coming up, appreciating the values of what they have. I think most Americans don't realize what we do have here. Now, I've lived out of the country for 10 years mm-hmm. in non-military, and you really appreciate when you come back what we have. And I think more and more is taken for granted, and which I don't think it should be. I think it's something that everyone should earn. Everyone should have a feeling of, contribution. Teach your youngsters, help your oldsters, help each other. But don't just be takers. If you take something, give something.
Right.
And it has to be, because if it doesn't, we'll wind up like the Roman Empire, we'll wind up like the Third Reich, we'll wind up like them all.
Right.
In a mess, in a heap. But I think from when you see this and what goes on, and the people that do the volunteering, that's where I think we're still a country that has an awful lot of potential and an awful lot to offer. And with that, I'll say good night. You're welcome.
Yay!
Embrace me, you we will play. Just one look at you, my heart grew tipsy. Thank you.
the association here, the Cass and Young Association. And of course, in World War II, I served on the Fletcher-class destroyers also, namely the USS McGowan DD-678, which you add that up and spells 21. But Monday is D-Day, of course, and I know everybody is celebrating that. But when that was happening, we on the other side of the world were on our invasion, too. We were on our way to Saipan and in the Marianas campaign. And of course, D-Day broke, and everybody was waiting for that, and that took precedence over everything. So, but we were there, we were in it. And we were in the invasions all the way up till the end of it. And the McGowan took 10 battle stars out of the Pacific campaign. So we were there. So what else can I tell you?
Well, what do you think about the celebration?
Oh, I think it's wonderful. Well, working on the ship down here, the Cass and Young, of course, and being a destroyer man, that's all in our blood. Because they built 175 Fletchers during the war, and there's a lot of sailors that sailed on it. So here we are tonight, and I think it's fantastic.
You having a good time tonight?
Oh yeah, I love the music. It's really great. So,
you want to say something?
Just looking around at these old guys. I think it's great.
Great. Anything else you
want to
say?
Oh, that's funny, I think.
Still the same old story. A fight for my word. I can't serve the world. The world will always welcome us.
Lieutenant Colonel Joseph McGonigal with the U.S. Army, and I like to just say that I started as an enlisted man, and I'm now a colonel, you know? And you asked me why I like the USO, because I always found that on, you know, when you got your pass and went out, you know, you always liked the place to go. The USO was always there. They always had good dance music and everything else when I was in the service. You know?
This reminds you of the USO here tonight?
Huh? Excuse me.
This reminds you of the USO?
Oh, yes, it does. The music is tremendous. You know, nowadays you can't get an orchestra anymore. They only have DJs mostly all around the places, you know. And
does it take you
it's
back?
It's not the same music, you know.
Does it take you back to the day?
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure. It takes me back. Oh, yeah.
Is it the same music? Is it the same kind of music?
Oh, yes. Yeah, that's Glenn Miller music and everything. The music's of the 40s and 50s. That's when I was in. Yeah. And with D-Day Monday, it's going to be a sad day for me because I lost a lot of buddies on the invasion there, but I didn't go back this year. I had some eye trouble, so I couldn't travel, you know. So the world can't stop, you know. But we should take time to remember the veterans, especially those who died. I think a younger generation, in my theory, they have no idea of war or anything, and no appreciation. I was in a couple of Memorial Day parades. And I was surprised to see the ignorance. The flag went by, half the kids don't take their hats off. They don't salute the flag at all. In fact, they don't even go down the cemetery, they don't go anywhere. They just have no idea what's going on. You know? But I thank God there's no war now. And I hope in my day I don't see another one, okay? Okay, thank you.
Well, so you're having a good time tonight.
Oh, yes, I'm having a lovely time here. Yeah.
I'll be loving you always, with a love that's true always. When the things you plan need a helping hand, I will understand always, always. Days may not be fair, always. That's when I'll be there, always. Not for just an hour,
some sealer, I
don't know. Oh, jeepers. I'd start worrying if I were you.
Yeah.
So you having a good time here tonight?
Oh, yes, we're having a great time. I was glad they invited us.
How did you participate? How are you involved? Why did they invite you as a veteran? Or?
Well, I'm the past commander of our chapter in North Andover.
Oh, great.
With the DAV, Disabled American Veterans. Yeah.
And how did you serve?
I was in the Coast Guard for 3 years. Yeah. I was on submarine patrol duty in the North Atlantic.
So does this bring you back, this kind of music?
Oh, this type of music and the atmosphere here, USO style. That's the first place we tried to seek out when we hit the beach. The local USOs. A lot of fond memories there.
Are there any guys here tonight that you served with?
No, I don't see anybody here that I recognize. Of course, it's been quite a few years since 1943, so people change through the years. It might take a while to recognize somebody that you're familiar with. But we're having a great time here. I'm glad they invited us.
All right, and do you like the band?
Well, there's a guy I know over there.
See, there you go. Do you like the band?
Yes, the band is wonderful. They play a lot of the oldies.
I mean, I was on the Pacific side, okay? That was a different war over here than the one over there. You guys worry about your side, I'll worry about my side. This event, I'm interested in.
Yeah.
It brings back memories.
Yeah.
With the television going all this past week, that's all you've been seeing is the D-Day operation.
Right.
So, it's just part of the operation.
Yeah. But where were you?
Where was I?
Yeah.
Early June of 44.
Yep. Where were you?
In the Pacific.
Yeah.
Joining up with the, no, we were convoying a group of ships headed towards Saipan. Or we were getting ready to do that operation.
Yep.
So we were either down in the Majuro's Island or someplace down in the Pacific.
Yep.
Some of the garden spots.
Okay, yeah. And you were on the Castagnan?
Yes, I was.
And what were you doing on the Castagnan? What job?
I was a fire controlman. What was my job?
What was your job? Tell me more about it.
Oh, setting up the equipment to make the guns fire properly, making sure that...
The 5-inch guns, the 40s, the 20s, all of them?
5-inch and the 40s, basically.
Okay.
And then what do we do? Telephones will work. Make sure the telephones are working.
The voice activated.
The voice activated.
Little switches going sometimes, or...
Oh, you've been reading the books and studying the equipment.
Absolutely.
Oh, good. I got to tell Mr. Foley you're doing your job.
Give me a raise.
Quick. And being bored at times.
Being bored.
Yeah.
That's an interesting observation. Sure, it wasn't all excitement.
No.
No.
Have
you
to
sat
work.
Around.
Yeah.
Well, waiting for stuff to happen.
That's right.
So what did you do to pass the day? How did you kill the boredom?
Played cards, wrote letters.
Who'd you write letters to?
I wasn't married at the time.
Now, your girlfriend?
My girlfriend,
yeah.
My mother,
yeah.
My father,
yeah.
Other people.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm trying to remember. It's,
yeah.
It's a few weeks ago, so time flies when you're having fun.
Did you go out and have fun? Did you go out to the USO?
I went aboard the Cass & Young in November of 43. We left the States in March of 44 and didn't get back until August, September of 45. So we didn't set foot on land except for a couple of the little islands out there. And they didn't move the USO where we were going.
And so you were there for the kamikaze attacks then?
Oh, yeah.
On the Castagnan?
Yeah. Fun and game time.
Fun and game time.
Mm. Well, we got came back in August of, end of August of 45, uh-huh. Went home for 30 days,
yeah.
Went back out to the Castagnan, where we were in Long Beach getting fixed up.
Right.
And then got transferred off in December of 45 to head for Boston and discharge. So I got out.
And you went home?
Yeah.
Did you go home and get married or no?
No,
you just
no.
Just had the girlfriend back then? And
oh, it was a different girlfriend.
Different girlfriend.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Let's not get into that.
No,
we don't
into
want
that.
To get
no.
into that.
And so how did people react to you coming home? Were you like kind of like a local hero or was
no.
just like everybody else?
Everybody else was, you know, family
yeah.
was good, glad to see me. I was
yeah.
glad to be home.
Sure. And that was that.
But the job was over and done with. Now let's get on. The only thing I mentioned to John, in the 40s, we never had amplifiers for the band.
Oh, that's true. It was all just whatever they put
whatever
out,
was there, that was it.
Yeah, that's true. This is newfangled stuff. Yeah, that's true.
Hot on the ears.
Thank you.
Well, when we started out a few years ago, when the Cass and Young came into Boston, you know, all of a sudden everything started waking up. All the memories started coming. Then we started an association and a reunion. And I can't tell you how many phone calls I made throughout the country trying to find people. And if you find one person, ask them if you know somebody else.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and then it just mushrooms.
Yep.
And we had a big reunion up here.
That's right.
Up in the hall room. No, I'm talking the very first one we had, like about 12 years ago.
Oh, okay.
You're talking about Cheers and, oh, jeez.
But they thought they'd never see that ship.
Oh, I never thought of it.
How many were on the Cassidy?
The full complement during the war was 320.
So over the years,
people used to say, what do you do with 300 people? Well, 300 people, some worked, some slept, and some stayed on watch.
So what do you think about a night like tonight? You're enjoying it, you're having fun?
Oh, having a great time. Just reminiscing, that's the main thing. And like I say, with people your own age and people with the same memories, you might not have been in the same places, but it all runs together, you know.
For your help. Well, also, a couple of folks that I acknowledged earlier who weren't here have since arrived. I'd like to acknowledge that Mr. Jim Conway, past state president of the American Legion, and past National Historian of the American Legion. Also, Sumner Wheeler, president of the Cass and Young Association. Thank you again, Sumner, and your organization for all your help tonight. Also, I'd like to acknowledge a number of gentlemen who are here from the Chelsea Soldiers Home. If you'd like to raise your hands, gentlemen. Okay, all unattached women, please pay attention. We thank you all for coming tonight. Thank you, and I'm glad you get back. You may carry on, as they say.
Ration book. It's my own.